Climate change. You've probably heard of it now. Ravages the news, breaking headlines from accounts of extreme heat to earthquakes to flooding cities to volcanic eruptions to destroy homes and the environment alike. We are heading towards a doomsday event that could cause irreversible effect to humans. But it was caused by humans. Yes, you heard that right. Our actions caused this. Our industrial revolution almost 200 years ago has made this climate crisis that we're trapped in today. So what are we doing to reverse these effects that we've caused? I want to focus on the climate action bill that Ireland is implementing to do this. The bill plans to transition Ireland to net zero carbon emissions by 2050. But why are they doing this, and what's the chance that this plan works? Today I want to answer these questions. What is the climate action bill? Why do we need it? Before we explore these questions, we need to understand why I chose this project over any other.
I chose this project because climate change is one of the biggest challenges and problems facing my generation. I wanted to know what my country, Ireland, was doing to address these problems and decided that the bill would be the perfect place to investigate.
It's one of the biggest changes Ireland has made and I want to see how influential it has been. Climate change is such a large problem and I want to know that my country, the government, recognises it as such and taking the proper steps to solve the problem in Ireland. By investigating what the Climate Action Bill is, I can answer these questions and I can find out if enough has been done to combat the climate crisis. This is my future and all of the young people's future, so it's of utmost importance to me that enough has been done.
So, I want to find out what the Climate Action Bill is and answer this first question.
Climate Action Bill, also known as the Climate Action Low Carbon Development Bill, is a bill to support Ireland's transition to a net zero carbon society and to achieve a climate neutral economy by no later than 2050. It was published in 2021 during March and now provides a legal basis for the approval of plans by the government about climate change. What is the background to this bill? In 2015, the Climate Action Low Carbon Development Act Bill was passed. This made a national climate policy for the entire country. This was the first time that the country had a statutory aim to pursue a low-carbon, climate-resilient and environmentally sustainable economy by 2050. Then in 2020, the Draft Climate Action Low Carbon Development Bill was developed. This was the same bill that we have in present day, but the draft for it. This set a national 2050 climate objective and introduced a successive 5-year carbon budget from 2021. The pre-legislative scrutiny of the first draft happened when the Orkdrus Joint Committee on Climate Action made recommendations on the 2020 draft. These included target structures, greenhouse gas, including methane and nature-based solutions, and biodiversity. In 2021, the draft was finalised and it became what the bill we know today. What does the bill plan to enact and do to achieve such ambitious goals? For this, we must look and analyse the bill. The first few years will be a carbon budget. These budgets are the reason we have the chance to meet a 50% reduction by 2030, relative to the 2018 baseline. These budgets represent the total amount of emissions that can be released in these 5 years. So what are the carbon budgets for Ireland? Well, from 2021 to 2025, only 295 megatons of CO2, or 295 million tons of carbon dioxide, are likely to be emitted this period. Then from 2026 to 2030, we can only emit 200 megatons. CSO for this period. The role of the Climate Change Advisory Council has been strengthened. This council is an independent advisory body that brings together evidence-based advice and recommendations on what to do to support Ireland's transition to a net carbon society. It was developed in the Act in 2015 that we mentioned earlier. Actions for each sector, such as transport, education, and industry, will have a mandatory detail in the Climate Action Plan, which is updated annually, separate to the bill. Also, every long-term climate action strategy, which will set up pathways for Ireland to achieve carbon neutrality by 2050. These strategies will build upon the already existing carbon budget and the climate action plan that will be made each year. These strategies will have emissions removed by the entire country as well as each department and expected progress on transitions to low greenhouse gas emissions. It will also detail the expected socio-economic effects of decarbonisation measures such as social development and health risks. The bill also introduces a requirement for each local authority to make a climate action plan and that authority development plans will align with the climate action plan that they prepared. Lastly, public bodies will also be obliged to perform their functions about the national climate plans and strategy. They must also adhere to the goal of furthering the achievements of the national climate objective. These measures that the bill puts in place are extensive and strict. They require each department and public body to fill out a yearly climate plan, and they must require the whole country of Ireland to adhere to carbon budgets. Why do we need such extensive and strict rules? To this, we look at the biggest problem humanity has ever faced. Climate change refers to long-term changes in the Earth's weather patterns or average temperatures. It is one of the largest reasons for the Climate Action Bill, but not the only one. Ireland's bill provided to meet the manual international EU climate commitments. This provides Ireland with the opportunity to become a leader rather than a lagger in climate change, and provide a stepping stone for others to do the same. This also increases the importance that this bill works. Some of the causes of climate change can be attributed to natural events such as volcanic eruptions, fluctuations in solar radiation, tectonic shifts, even changes in the Earth's orbit. The reasons for these events make impacts on climate change because of the release of gas. For example, solar radiation. As the sun hits down the Earth, it heats up and melts the ice. Because the ice is a carbon sink, it's a lot of stored up greenhouse gases, which when it melts, it releases. Also, ice is a key component in returning solar rays to space, as the white color of ice reflects the solar rays. When we have more solar radiation, we melt this ice, removing our ability to reflect solar rays on top of the release of gas that is already happening. This, in combination with the other natural events that have made the atmosphere slowly fill up with carbon dioxide that trap in the sun rays. Not get me wrong, the sun's rays are extremely beneficial to humans, providing us with trees, food and life on Earth. When we get a lot of it, we cannot release this heat, and well, our planet gets warm and temperature rises. If we compare the cause of climate change as a product of natural events versus humans, it's like comparing an ant to the Empire State Building. So, the biggest reason for climate change is due to humans. You, I, teachers, principals, philosophers, doctors, lawyers, presidents, and every other human in this blue marble we call Earth, we all have contributed. For almost 200 years, humans have been responsible for all the global heating that's put us in this crisis. How do we know? Well, Guy Callender, an amateur scientist, made history by going around the world to take records from 147 stations across the world. He found out that the global temperature had risen by 0.3 degrees over the past 50 years. Then, in 1958, a young postgraduate geochemist named Charles David Keeling compared the amount of CO2 in the water and air. This was the first time the CO2 had been evaluated in the atmosphere, which made equipment basically non-existent. So he designed his own equipment, and after 5 years of meticulous measurements, he proved the CO2 levels were rising.
After this, Keeling analysed his work and found that the rise of CO2 levels could be attributed to the rise of fossil fuels. This was the first evidence of the horrible damage we were doing to our planet.
But how do we know greenhouse gases cause a temperature rise? Well, fossil fuels are fuels such as coal, gas and oil, and burning them releases and generates greenhouse gas emissions. Some of the gases that cause this heat are carbon dioxide and methane. But the problem with this is as so. Earth is often called the Goldilocks planet, which means its conditions are simply perfect. Not too hot and not too cold. One of the key reasons for this is because of greenhouse gases, as they keep heat in, allowing us not to be a frozen planet, and what is known as a carbon cycle, where reflected solar rays are kept in by the Earth's atmosphere by greenhouse gases to give the world heat. When humans use these greenhouse gases excessively, there becomes an imbalance, and we begin to have too thick an atmosphere. There's not ventilating enough greenhouse gases. Our activities, such as driving a car to school or heating the home for Christmas, releases gases, which is quite a few people in the world who do these activities. So you can see how this can be a problem. Also, human greed causes climate change, as well with power-hungry people cutting down forests, deforestation, for wealth releases massive amounts of carbon dioxide. Agriculture, oil and gas are also a huge source of methane emissions, as for example, cows release methane, and as we use them even more for agriculture, we increase the number of cows we release, which means more methane. Agriculture is even more problems to stop the methane emissions. When farmers want more cattle, they must cut down land to tame the extra space, which emits carbon dioxide through deforestation. In fact, this was first discovered in 1988. We saw the summer of this year being the hottest on record, causing widespread droughts and wildfires. Little did they know, I will get so much worse.
temperatures as we may know. The last decade has been the warmest on record since the 1980s. All land areas have seen more hot days and heat waves. This increases heat-related illness and wildfires across the globe. More severe storms will ravage the world, destroying houses, villages and cities alike. As temperatures rise, the water surface of the ocean increases, which is what cyclones, hurricanes and typhoons feed on. These storms destroy everything in their path and cause huge destruction and economic loss. As these temperatures rise, it causes drought. Global warming exasperates water shortages in countries that already deal with droughts and copper lore. People are left hungry, thirsty, and a lot of time dead. These droughts can also stir up destructive sand and dust storms and cause desertification and less good land for food to grow on, increasing starvation. Climate change poses severe risk to survival species now. Earth's existing species are rated 1,000 times greater than any time in human history. Their habitats are destroyed, and these animals are left to try and relocate and perish in the process. We also must deal with more health risks. Climate change increases air pollution, disease, extreme weather events, and pressure on mental health. For every environmental factor, it takes the lives of more than 13 million people, which is more than twice the population of Ireland. Finally, poverty and space are a product of climate change. Floods and weather events sweep away homes and urban slums, and heat can make it so impossible to work an outside job. Over the past decade, weather-related events have faced an estimated 23.1 million every single year. Every single year, every animal, three times the population of New York, is in despair, lost, thirsty, hungry, homeless, their lives destroyed.
If we keep this trend of climate change and fossil fuel release, we're heading towards a world ravaged by climate change events, a world where people die of heatstroke and displaced by the next earthquake or tsunami that has almost become too common. Although it is unlikely humans will go extinct, almost zero in fact, because of climate crisis, it is likely that the climate crisis will destroy human lives in developing countries that are less fortunate, making a need for a climate action plan or bill as clear as daylight. Will this climate action bill actually work? The need for a solution, a hope, is evident and necessary, such as Climate Action Bill 2030. What is the likelihood that something like this saves us from such a big crisis? Well, if we look at the individual reports for each sector over the years, we get a good gauge on how successful the bill has been. According to a 2022 report, in electricity, the annual emissions over the next 3 years must be less than 7 megatons, from 2022 to 2025. Yet our annual average from 2022 to 2021 has been more than 10 megatons. This has happened because electricity demand is growing, and while a renewable energy can provide for some of this continued reliance on coal electricity, it makes it exceedingly difficult to cut down on these emissions. For buildings and industries, their annual emissions must be 11 megatons, but their annual average over the past years is 50 megatons. To achieve the goal that we set, the industry is likely to have to change radically to accommodate the bill, such as retrofitting with also increased renewable heat supply and energy efficient additions. If we look at transport, their annual emissions need to be under 11 megatons. But if we analyse their last 2 years' emissions, we see that Ireland's average is a bit more than 11 megatons. This is the first industry where we see that they're meeting their goals. This does not include the COVID-19 pandemic, which reduced transport usage. So along these lines, the transport industry will have to reduce car dependency, increase other forms of transport that do not have emissions, such as cycling, and increase biofuels. They will also have to accelerate the sale of electric vehicles, but they need to be careful of how these vehicles are produced. And if they are produced with fossil fuels, then they are no longer as good. If they are produced sustainably, then great. Lastly, in agriculture, the annual emissions need to be less than 20 megatons, but our average annual emissions have been more than 23. While there have been development in the agricultural industry, it has been offset by growth in dairy cow numbers. So what does it mean for the bill and success rate? Climate change will not be fixed today. Likely, it will not be fixed for decades from now. But Ireland's bill, although along the right lines and is good progression, we need radical change. From December 2022, 40% through the lifetime of the carbon budget, we emitted 47% of our emissions. If we look at the 2023 Climate Action Plan, there have been advances made to help these industries to get their targets, such as industry sector. There was a launch of 55 million euro green transition fund, and electricity to the first grid-scale solar project. Also, the budget from 2026 to 2030 is meant to have lower emissions, which gives us time and opportunity to save the planet. But still, we are above our goals, and we are left with the effect such as the hottest summer ever on record in Ireland and llama storms. However, this is expected, since we are trying to make a huge change for the country in such a short time. While necessary, it is hard, and it will take time to set up the proper infrastructure for this such, such as electric cars and solar panels.
We also have a lot of work to go to achieve the goals set out by the bill.
But if Ireland can keep funding sectors and putting money into the bill, then yes, there is a chance that the bill could work. There needs to be more action, especially in sectors such as agriculture, transportation, which are our biggest emitters. This year, your voice can help us change unite. If we unite, we have the power to build, put this bill on the route to success. This plan will affect all young people's future the most, and now it's time to make sure that it's for the good. You have the voice to make the change for your future, Ireland and the rest of us. Ireland's actions now, although mandatory by EU standards, are provided to be stepping stone for others to do the same. We have a chance to influence others to solve the climate crisis, such as China or the United States, which are some of the world's biggest emitters, who are doing something about the climate crisis, but like us, not enough. A lot more needs to be done as climate change is of huge importance and threat to everyone. It's an incredibly valuable time in Ireland and the world's history if this bill works. And if this bill works, we can make other countries also develop their own bills or plans for a net carbon society, push the world away from the doom climate change possesses. Climate Band in Ireland provides so much importance even outside of Ireland, and your voice can push it to success. This is Hungry World, take me to church. I was like a dog at the shrine of your life. I'll tell you my sins so you can sharpen your knife. Offer me my deathless death, the good God, let me give you my life. Take me to church, I was like a dog.
There is no sweeter innocence.